Welcome to Pigeon River Farm, doing farming right. I'm Robert Brown, the owner of Pigeon River Farm. Thank you for viewing.
Okay, so the topic I'm going to talk about is ORP, and I'll just give you a little background on how it was only about 5 or 6 months ago that I really started looking at this ORP number. And what got me started was there's a digester that is looking at trying to be built in our township. And so as I started researching and looking at digesters, one of the things that came up was industrial wastewater. And with that, I started looking at the treatment of wastewater, which led me into some of the municipal situations where they have to put this water back in the river or creek. And so as I was looking at that, these water treatment plants, the ORP reading is basically the main thing that they constantly look at. So as I was looking, again, paging through the internet, looking at different things on ORP, I noticed some information that came up in agriculture. And I'll actually write this fellow's name down. He has a 20-page article that talks about ORP. And the thing that hit me the most is he stated that he feels that the ORP reading is as important, if not more important, than what the pH reading is in the soil. That's a pretty huge statement, and I didn't know what ORP was. And so some of the first part of this presentation is going to be kind of technical, but as we get through it, I think it'll make more sense. But the researcher's name, the Frenchman, it's, I believe it's Olivier Hussein, or Hussein. And his research paper was pretty impressive. He probably has probably 8 pages of references in the back. And unfortunately, most of these references come from research over in Europe. And there's very little of any information that I've seen that is coming from the US. So why? I don't know. So to start out, what is ORP? What does that mean? Well, if you look at those three letters, it stands for oxidation reduction potential. Another term for it is redox. And also, when a lot of the research we're looking at, when they're talking about it, they'll have a capital E and an H when they're talking about the redox or ORP, so they don't have to use that phrase over and over again. We look at the definition for redox in a chemical equation. We're looking at the situation where electrons, or something that's negatively charged, is either gained or lost. Okay? So this is actually an electrical reading that we're taking. Okay, as stated, it's we take this measurement of ORP meter, and I actually have one here. So essentially, this is usually used in liquids. So it's basically put into the liquid and you let it stabilize for until the numbers stabilize and get the reading. Now, what gets to be the problem is if we're trying to do soil. They can do like a slurry and mix distilled water with it and take a reading. But the problem gets to be, we remove the soil from its natural state, and that's going to change that ORP reading. So ideally, what we really need to have is something where we put a meter directly into the soil out in the field. At this point, from what this researcher had talked about, they really don't have the equipment yet to do that, I guess, as accurately as they like to. So that type of equipment isn't quite there yet. Okay, if we look at, I actually have some numbers over here. I have a reading all the way up here from a plus 950 millivolts all the way down to a negative 300 millivolts. Okay, if we're looking at, okay, we have a either oxidation or reduction with the ORP meter. What is it when we have oxidation? So oxidation, we have a positive reading. So if we're looking at, if I stick this meter into some liquid, and let's say I have 700 reading, that means it's an oxidative agent. Okay? And so what does that mean if it's an oxidative agent? It means it's capable of taking on electrons. Okay? And it also means it's a situation where electrons are relatively unavailable. So if we're up at this upper level here, and we look at the number of electrons, we might have, let's say, a few electrons. And when we get down to this bottom side, which we're going to be getting into, there's going to be a bunch of electrons available.
You pushed your button to go back, right?
Okay, we talked about the positive reading. Now, the opposite of that is that negative reading. That means we have a reductive substance. And so we're going to get lower on this scale. And so if we have a reducing product, that means that electrons are highly available. If we look at this from a standpoint in the soil, if we have in a soil that we term aerobic, which means with oxygen, we're generally going to get a reading that's going to be higher on the scale. As we move into a soil that we would quote call anaerobic or low in oxygen, we're going to get an ORP reading that's going to be more on the lower side or negative. Okay? The thing to remember is, like Keith was talking about, how our hormones react in plants. This reaction happens in the soil. This reaction happens in us. This reaction happens in plants. And it's happening continuously. There's a gaining of electrons and a taking on of electrons continuously. It's not a static number that we're going to run into. And that's why we're going to have more of a range in our ORP readings than we will like with pH or even the elements that we have in the soil like N, P, or K. Okay, if we look at the soil aspect, the sweet zone is going to be, written up here, is going to kind of be from this 450 to 400 in a positive range. This is kind of the zone where most plants are going to do the best as far as growth, production, yield. And if we look at, I have a line written under this, 300 plus 350. Once we start getting below 350 for an ORP reading, that plant is really going to start hurting as far as being able to grow and photosynthesize the way it should. Now the general, if we look in, actually what would be considered a normal fluctuation in most of our soils, it's kind of surprising, it actually goes from probably about the 700 down to 300 is very, very common. And so this is how much swing we have in this reading throughout the growing season with all the different changes as far as moisture, temperature, anything down that line. So it's fairly significant. On the extreme end, we have like plus 950 to minus 300. And this is what we can have many soils that aren't in good condition can actually fluctuate this much. So again, this number fluctuates way more than like what pH or anything else does. But the whole thing that we're looking at is trying to keep it in this sweet zone.
Time to go right back again.
Okay, the two elements that I'm going to look at is going to be oxygen and hydrogen. And as you might think, if we look at...
You're on the side.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe it's
is that?
We're quick learners.
Yeah. Wait till I hand out the test paper.
Well, all a test paper does is show how good teachers are.
If we use one man, you want to go one more.
What do I do with the eyes and go? Oh,
yeah. Okay. Oxygen is a strong oxidizer. Okay, we're looking at ORP. Where's Enos here? We're going to give him a question since he. If we have oxygen and it's a strong oxidizer, where is it going to fall in this range from positive to negative if you would venture a guess?
Probably on the top end.
Yep. Yes. Okay, it's a strong oxidizer, so it's going to be on the upper level. And if it's a strong oxidizer, it's normally going to what? Is it going to have a tendency to take on electrons or donate electrons? It's going to have a tendency to take them on. So if we look at, O is here, which is the sign for oxygen. If we have an oxygen molecule and it loses an electron, I mean it gains an electron. I should know it's going to lose an electron. It actually becomes a negative because if it's neutral, and if we look at hydrogen, hydrogen normally is going to donate electrons, so it's going to lose its negativity. We're going to have a plus sign by it. That's a lot of times we see some molecules and they'll have like H with a positive or O with a negative, like OH negative. What's kind of giving us is what has happened as far as either something that has gained an electron or lost an electron. Okay? So the, if we looked at, again, the soil, if we have a high oxygen level in it, we're going to be running into these millivolt readings that are higher. As we move into an anaerobic soil, we're going to move into ORP readings that are more on the negative side. And again, we need to remember that this is a continual process of atoms either gaining electrons or losing electrons, continuously throughout the process. Okay, we already stated this on if we get below that 350, the plant growth rapidly decreases. And so, generally, the problem is these extreme fluctuations up and down, away from what this kind of the sweet zone is. And the reason that's important, if we move away from this 450 to 400 positive millivolts, what the plant is going to do, let's say we get up into the range that's up in the 700 or above, what the plant is actually going to do, it's going to expend energy and it's going to produce compounds that it's going to release it through its roots, trying to bring this millivolt reading down into this range. And the same thing if we get down in this lower range, it's going to have the try to release, again, compounds into the root system to bring this millivolt reading up into the ideal zone. But the reason this is a problem, then, this plant is expending energy not for seed production or growth. It's just expending energy trying to get it back in this area where it can utilize nutrients. And so the whole idea we're trying to do is bring our, we're going to have these natural fluctuations, but let's try to minimize what these fluctuations end up doing. That's the whole idea that we're going to try to do when we look at these, this ORP number. Okay, what are some of the areas where we're going to have ORP readings too high? Most of your chemical fertilizers are going to be oxidizers. That means when we use commercial fertilizers, we're going to have a tendency to keep on pushing that ORP reading up. So we're looking at our nitrogen sources, most of your, basically all your, most of your NP and K products are going to be in that range. So if we'd even take, like you look at DAP or urea, any of those, if we would liquefy those and put that in a liquid and have this ORP meter, we see readings that are going to be on the high range. On the herbicides, insecticides, fungicides, those are all going to be, again, most of those are going to be in that positive ORP reading. The problem with, besides what it's going to have an effect on the soil, is also the effect that it's going to have on a plant. So if we come with a, for example, a herbicide or insecticide or fungicide and spray it on the plant, it's also going to move that plant's ORP or redox number into too high of a range. And this can be a problem because if we have a plant or even a soil that moves in too high of a redox number, that plant is going to be more susceptible to disease and pathogens as we move up that scale. So we could be spraying, for example, a fungicide on to try to prevent a fungus, and because we drive those ORP numbers up, we actually could be inducing disease in our plants. So that's a thing to keep in mind. Now the next one that I'm going to talk about would be the tillage aspect. And if we look at a way to, again, a way to maintain more in this sweet zone is we don't want to excessively till that soil. So if we go out there, let's say with a rotor tiller or something that's going to mix that whole top 6-7 inches in a complete powdery mix, what do we add to that loose soil when we agitate it all up? Oxygen. So as soon as we add the oxygen to it, and if we do it excessively, this is going to move way too high. So what is one of the ways that we can hopefully mitigate that problem? We want to try to keep the soil structure that we have there. So you know, like last year we talked about like the smart till or some tillage equipment where it would still aerate the soil but not destroy the soil structure. And that's kind of what we're looking at. Because if we can have that situation where we maintain the soil structure, we're not going to get these excess spikes in the redox number. And if we go on the opposite side, if we get moisture and we have the soil structure there, that the soil will be able to handle the moisture and be able to drop or reduce that moisture quicker than if we have it all completely worked up and it becomes oversaturated with water. Because if we go and have excess water in that top 6 to 7 inches, what do we end up driving out of the soil? The air. So as we have, for example, soils that are flooded, what is that ORP reading going to do if we have flooded soil? Oxygen is gone, so it's going to move down. So if we can, again, have a soil structure that can handle during dry weather, will maintain its moisture better. And if we can have the other situation where if we do get moisture, it can dry out quicker. And that will happen if we can maintain that soil structure and that air and water movement.
Question here. Yeah. We've been having some discussion with our consultant, and she was telling us that the people that are using this vertical tillage are the mycotoxins are at unacceptable rates. Now, would that have anything to do with this? That's just loosening up that little bit on the top, could that, I mean, could they, and they don't understand why, they just know that's this happened.
Right. I think as we get further in here, the what I'm looking at is the possibility of how are we changing that ORP reading. Are we, for example, if they go to minimum tillage and let's say we're not disturbing that soil as much, now when we do apply anything and it's more, let's say, in the top part of the soil, are we negatively affecting this ORP and it's going too high? Like, for example, then should, along with it, if they're doing this vertical tillage, should they be looking at maybe reducing their fertilizer that they use or splitting the applications? Maybe those type of things. I think it's correlated to this ORP, but I don't know exactly how it could be correlated to it.
The herbicide, all that would affect it. If it, and the more you loosen, we'll say it dilutes it out.
Right.
The tighter, the smaller area, it would make that more apt to concentrate that
right. I guess the other big thing in that whole equation is, for me, is what type of crops are they producing? Is it genetically modified? Is it conventional? That type of thing. Because I don't even know if we throw the variable of genetically modified crops and the residue from organic GMO material, how is that affecting our ORP? I don't know.
Yeah,
it'll be interesting to find out if it's related more to people. Well,
she said they don't. They did all kinds of tests. They just and they can't figure out any reason. They just know what's happening.
Okay. Does she know if the people are using genetically modified corns?
I'm thinking more so because she's talking about there's several in like Central Sands area. She says that they're buying feed elsewhere to try to offset because it's so poisonous that the cows are dying.
Okay. Well, when I get a little bit further in here, we'll maybe talk a little about some of the sand issue and how that could be correlated to that mycotoxin issue. Next one is going to be low organic matter. If we look at the carbon level or the organic matter in the soil, that's basically an electron storage unit in the soil. So the higher that we can have that carbon level, the more beneficial it's going to be. And so again, if we look at, we've known that we should try to increase our organic matter, but I think we could correlate it back to how we could affect that ORP number positively if we can maintain a higher level, especially like in sands. Okay, this one would be a little bit different. If we look at the situation of photosynthesis is probably the largest reducing situation in plant growth. So from the process of photosynthesis, if it's a reduction, act of reduction or a reducing process, that means it's going to be donating a lot of electrons and it's going to be more on the bottom end. So it's kind of a balance between if we have, let's say, a positive millivolt reading, for example, in a plant, and we have photosynthesis, there's going to be a reaction between the elements that are in the plant on a positive level and other elements along with the act of photosynthesis. Again, it's going to be this gain and loss of electrons, but photosynthesis is going to be major in the reduction side on the bottom end. So if we have these plants that are planted too close together, let's say a 35,000 plant population, what's going to happen is that plant doesn't have enough area to photosynthesize the way it should, and that process is more on the lower or negative side. And if it can't do that and it's too close together, that means that we're going to be on the higher end, that our plant is going to be actually too highly oxidized. And then so if we have any
of the root mass or organic matter that we have left over from taking the crop off, it's actually going to be an oxidized, more oxidized or a higher millivolt residue that we're going to be putting into the soil. So it's a little different concept, but that's, you know, actually what's happening when we look at photosynthesis. It's a highly reducing situation. And so if we can give those plants the adequate space, they're going to be able to, again, have enough of the electrons available along with reacting with the positive side within the plant. Okay, how do we stabilize so we can keep in this sweet zone better? The obvious is just plant vegetation. You know, we look at how the last 4 to 5 years we've been talking more about green manure crops. And so this is a lot what this is related to. So if we're talking about that generally our soils tend to be too oxidized, if we can have a plant that photosynthesizes, if we have photosynthesis, it's going to be a reducing situation, so it's going to help bring down that redox number a little bit, especially if you tend to be on the high side. So just the plants being on the soil. As far as specific plants, your end-fixing plants are going to be better, so we're looking at, you know, peas or vetch or clover. Those are all going to be more beneficial as far as, again, more of a reducing or lower ORP reading from residue that's going to come from nitrogen-fixing plants. The one category I didn't put on here, actually your brassicas, your turnips, your radishes are also going to be higher on the amount of reducing or reduction you're going to have from the organic matter you get from brassicas. Okay, the next one I have is use N-fix in foliar and soil sprays. In the past, you know, Keith has talked about how we seem to get disease control from using the N-fix. And so, as I got thinking about this, this is a green bean field. And the only thing that happened here is the fellow that was planting forgot to turn on the pump for a period of time. And all that was in the starter was foliar supplement, N-fix, and amoscripsil, right? Mm-hmm. Just those three. And so as I got thinking about that, we had some kind of a fungal issue in this soil, and that N-fix did something to prevent that from being a problem. So I started thinking, is there a possibility that we had a high ORP reading? So as we would run into a situation where we have excess oxidation, that we've maybe had more fungal issue, and if we can bring that ORP reading down, that fungus or bacteria can't survive in that situation. Because remember we talked before, if we start looking at too high oxidative levels, we're going to have more disease and pathogens show up. So the possibility exists that there's compounds that are produced by the bacteria and fungi in the N-fix that could be possibly reducing that millivolt reading right by the seed and then preventing this pathogen or disease situation from showing up. And I don't know for sure, but it's just a high hypothesis. Okay, the next one would be let plants go to seed. It kind of follows back with just planting vegetation. If we can let a plant go through its whole cycle and go to seed, we're going to have all that whole process of the plant adding, reducing material into the soil through its roots. Okay, so maybe once in a while it might not be a bad idea to let, like, the same alfalfa or grasses head out and go to seed. And especially we have conditions where we have redox numbers that are too high in the soil. This kind of goes back to the plant population. Just give the plants more room. And again, the photosynthesis is going to be improved. And again, we're going to have less oxidized plants if we can give them enough room. briefly talk to that. This raise our organic matter. Again, our organic matter, our carbon, is going to be a reservoir for electrons. And again, we're looking at a situation where generally we have redox numbers that are too high. So if we can have a electron reserve as far as our carbon or our organic matter, that's going to help us mitigate some of these high levels and keep that closer to that 400 to 450. Again, that reduced tillage would be, again, something that, whether it be like the Smart Till, Gen Till, and that Curse Presser all have the same type of design where it provides the ability for air to get in the soil, but it doesn't destroy the soil structure, so it doesn't completely mix the whole topsoil up and add too much oxygen to it. Reduce our chemical fertilizers, because we know most of our chemical fertilizers are high oxidizers. So maybe instead of applying, let's say, all of our nitrogen at one time, we could split that in two or three applications. That would all be a benefit. If we're looking at any of our herbicides, fungicides, that kind of thing, is there a way that we can reduce those by maybe using citric acid to lower the pH of the water so we can have reduced rates? This may seem pretty simple, but if we're looking at sand ground, if we look at sand, typically sand is going to have what? It's going to have a lower organic matter level. So if we have a lower organic matter level, we're going to have less reserve of our electrons, which is going to be a negative. And then with sand ground, we also have what? We have more pore space. So we have more air in between the particles of sand. So generally in sand, we're really looking at these levels that are too high just because of the characteristics of the sand itself and being low in organic matter or carbon. So a simple thing, which we don't really realize what we're doing, is when we irrigate that ground, as soon as you irrigate and water goes into there and drives some of the oxygen out, we bring that redox number down just by irrigation. Okay, so that's sand and how that affects our redox. If we go on the other end, and let's say we have somebody that has a field and he has a low spot, it's heavier ground, and so now he has a situation where he probably has high carbon level, so it's in blacker soil, and let's say it's in a low area where it tends to be too wet, and so he can't grow a crop decent, the field doesn't grow well. You take samples, the nitrogen, the phosphorus, the potassium all look good, the pH looks good, and it just doesn't grow a crop decent. Now he goes in and puts a drain tile in, grows phenomenal crops. What happened? It's possibly a situation where, because if he has a saturated soil, he has conditions that are just way too low on this redox level. He tiles the ground, gets that moisture level down, and that redox number comes up into the sweet zone. Now all the nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium that's there, the plant can finally use. You know, so I think these are some of the things that are happening in the background that we don't realize, and it's more than N, P, and K. And I think if we can understand some of these things better, we can better evaluate material that we're going to put on or when we're going to apply it to look at how we're going to affect this number. Okay? Any questions? Okay. Tied right to this, and as I was looking into some of the ORP or redox numbers that they're looking at water treatment plants and some of the discussion they had on that, I started looking at lagoon manure and some of the issues that we're probably having with that. So basically, in all of our, if you have a lagoon, it's going through an anaerobic digestion as it sits in the pit over the months. And so what that means is we have digestion that's happening without oxygen. It's oxygen that thrive, I mean bacteria that thrive in a low oxygen environment. The problem gets to be is in reality, I wish they'd use this term better, it's not really, I guess, anaerobic digestion, I wouldn't call it. It's actually putrefaction. What's happening is that manure is putrefying. And so what are the byproducts that we get from putrefaction? We get alcohol, aldehydes, methane, hydrogen sulfide. They don't sound like very good materials for feeding our soil life. So I would look at the putrefaction process and putrefying bacteria and their byproducts are not really a life-promoting aspect. It's more death related. If we look on the opposite end of that, and we look at an aerobic digestion, that means with oxygen, this is what happens when we do a compost, where if a person does a compost pile, and they come through with a compost turner or or whatever to get air into it. And with that breakdown, we actually get water, carbon dioxide, and I guess the other thing I put down here is the retention of hydrogen. If we go back here, you can see with the methane, there's four carbon atoms there that are lost in the gas. And in hydrogen sulfide, we have two hydrogen molecules that are lost in hydrogen sulfide. That's a loss of energy. If we look at just a situation where if we have diesel fuel or gas,
you put it in your pocket that time.
Get back to the baseline. So if we have diesel fuel or gas, what are the primary elements that are the makeup of that? It's basically C stands for carbon, H is for hydrogen, and O is for oxygen. Those are the three primary elements that are in a fuel. Now when we burn that in an engine, just like this, we get some carbon dioxide and some water from that. So where is our energy coming from? Our energy is coming from this hydrogen. That's what makes it work. So we look at an anaerobic situation, we've basically taken away a lot of the energy that our microsystem could have utilized because of that anaerobic digestion, where if we have anaerobic digestion, we're retaining that hydrogen. So that's, I think, a big component that we're missing. We're looking at, we're getting our NP and K, but we're losing that hydrogen. And that's way bigger of an issue than what you think. And I don't know many fertilizer plants that are selling hydrogen. And I think that's the problem. It's like if they can't sell it, they're not going to promote or talk about it. So again, that hydrogen is retained in that aerobic digestion. Okay, and this chart here, this information, a lot of this came from this William Tooley that did some research in 2009 to 2013. And when I got looking at this, the biggest take home I got was normally when we send these lagoon samples in, we get the standard, you know, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, the calcium, those type of things. But that doesn't really tell us what the quality of the manure is. And in this research, he's looking at what really makes a manure have a quality to it. And so the numbers that, or the items that he looked at that were important were the pH, the E. coli count, the volatile fatty acids, the conductivity, and the ORP reading of that manure. He said those are the primary things. If you have those in line, you're going to be able to utilize the N, P, and K that you have in that manure. Okay? So, typically what, in the anaerobic side, again, without oxygen, those are the readings that they normally ran into. Okay, they said like a pH of 8. I did some samples this fall, and the farms had the pH of 8.3, 8.4, and 8.5. So actually a little bit higher than that. If we look at the E. coli numbers, he had some research where they had some actually up to 20,000 colony-forming units per gram. But I think this was in a hog manure. And ideally, we wanted to get those down to 100. The samples that I did this fall, I had one that was 1,100, one that was 2,400, and one that was 4,600. So we were a far cry from getting down to that 100. If we look at our volatile fatty acids, the volatile fatty acids were important for him because he said if we can get that down to 150 or below, that manure will have very little smell to it. So the volatile fatty acid number is a big number to determine what the odor of that manure is going to be. And so the stuff that the manure that I sampled this fall, I actually had 2,850, one that was 323, and one that was down to 162. The next one is conductivity, and the reason I have that one blank there is at that time he didn't really have what some of the high numbers were. He recommended below 12, and he said ideally we'd get it down to 6. The readings that I had from the samples I took this fall were 9.2, 12.9, and 15.7. Okay, now the last one is the ORP, which is for me is the one of the key readings in the whole thing when you're looking at liquid manure. If you don't know your ORP reading, you don't even know what you have for material and how it's going to work. Okay, in his research, he's looking at a negative 220 millivolts was the reading. The samples that I took this fall, I had a negative 216, a negative 222, and a negative 287. So that's actually pretty close. Now on the right hand side, if we could have, let's say, an aerobic digestion with oxygen, we could have like a liquid compost. That's what we're looking at, is trying to get a liquid compost. And in that situation, we're going to get that pH down. Let me go back a little bit. Okay, now let's say we have a material like this, and let's say we have a negative 250 for a millivolt reading. And we're looking at a soil, let's say we have a situation where we're kind of in the sweet zone. We're at 400, 450. And now we're going to apply 10,000 gallons of manure, which would be about 50 ton. So we're gonna add 50 ton of this liquid slurry that has a negative 250 millivolt reading. What do you think is gonna happen to our sweet zone? It's gonna be gone. But even besides that sweet zone being gone, if we drop this drastically by adding this manure that has this negative millivolt reading, and we operate on a optimum millivolt reading, plants operate at a optimum millivolt reading, guess what happens to our microbes when we dump this and put that in front of them? Those microbes cannot handle these big swings and that big drastic negative reduction from this liquid manure. And so Mike,
what happens if it was fresh manure? Have they did any tests to say, hold it fresh, Where does that fit into this?
Well, the thing is, okay, now if we look at, you know, the whole idea, okay, if you do it fresh, okay, so then you put it out there, and we have a negative reading, but it's spread all out, and it's going to be exposed to what?
Air.
What's going to happen shortly? We're going to move that redox reading up fairly quick because we have oxygen available. And so it's actually going to turn it like into anaerobic digestion because we have oxygen available.
Another thing I just saw an observation. I ran into a big mega dairy guy, and he was having problems. This is over where they're having all the problems with manure getting in the water. And he was, so he, what he did is he takes semis now and he sprays all over on top. And he said by doing that, he says they were just trying to keep it better. He said, but the yields drastically went up. They were putting on hay ground. And he says, and he said, it's, and he ain't got mud around or nothing. He thought it was great.
But you can't do that though, you have to incorporate.
They're doing it right now. This, like I said, this is a big deer.
Yep.
Thousands of cows, and they had 15, 20 semis. They drove at like 50 miles an hour across the fields.
Right. So basically, what they're doing is, even though that initial product would be negative, that's changing relatively quick because it's exposed to the air. And so I think you could take that reading relatively soon after that. And it would rebound fairly quick.
His thought was that the plants were grabbing it before it got into the groundwater. Maybe had some left to it because it was on hay that you put it on.
Okay, well, if we look at some of these beneficial numbers as far as anaerobic digestion or compost, Jonas, can you talk about Jonas had a compost that he took, and he got some of these. At the time I talked to him, I had talked to him about ORP, so he was able to get a test on that. I hadn't talked to him about some of these other numbers, but he had a compost. You can just explain what you had last year.
I would have the conductivity should be on that.
Oh, your conductivity?
It should be on that.
Yeah.
But I didn't have the other numbers.
Right.
So it was basically, the compost was made of sawdust, deer carcasses, and liquid manure. And we applied that last spring, so this year's has an ORP reading of 326. Yeah. We don't know what last year's was, but I would guess it would have been the same. And the results we saw was amazing compared to like your regular manure and stuff like that.
Yeah, because you almost had double the yield on the first two crops than you would normally have.
We did. We had on the first crop and second crop, we got a little over 4 tons of dry matter off of the beach. I didn't know that was possible.
Yeah. And I believe, again, because he had some other compost. Okay, for example, his compost, the biggest two readings that I had, you know, not looking at the NP and K, the pH of the compost was 6.3, and the conductivity was a positive 326. And so again, he saw this phenomenal response there, but he had another compost that had an 8.1 pH, and we don't know what the millivolt reading was. I assume it was negative. And they didn't see anywhere near the response like they did on this other one that had this low pH and a high millivolt reading. And so that's why I think that this number is way more important than what we think, and especially when we have some possibilities we can look at the next year what ends up happening. But just the practical experience of this certain compost that he put on and got this phenomenal response. And he didn't get this with other compost that had numbers that weren't similar to that.
The one field I was spreading on a hay field, and I had two loads left from the first field that I spread, and I just went along the side with the last two loads, and then I spread from the other side, we spread with the other compost, and then I left a strip in the middle. The pH with the compost with a pH of 8, on the left side of the field, there was very little difference. On the right side of the field, there was very easily a 4-inch, if not a 6-inch jump where we spread those two loads. It was very obvious. Now, I'm going to add that this was a field with a high pH. Hydrogen okay. 0, and the pH was up in like around 7.
Okay.
So I don't know, would you think...
But the other thing is Jonas had
situation like that.
Jonas had sand ground, and so the situation he gets to be, there's a good possibility with that sand ground that he could be running into some actually excessive ORP numbers. That's why irrigation is going to be important for you, so you don't get these fluctuations. So on this sandy ground, the fluctuations in that ORP is going to be the biggest detriment. So I got thinking further on, when you got further into the season, it got dry, that alfalfa didn't do as good.
It didn't after the second crop. It kind of, I mean, it still did what the others did, but it didn't hold that extreme push like it had the first
time. Right. So I'm just wondering the possibility. Again, the soy got a little bit too dry, and did he actually get up in this upper range where the plant had to expend energy just to get this back down, mm-hmm. and so we lost some of that benefit. Mm-hmm. But again, with this whole thing, we're trying to minimize these fluctuations so that the plant doesn't have to expend energy with what it produces and puts into the soil to try to get back to the zone. One other thing I'll add here, there was some research that I looked at where there was, gets me to think. There was research in a company that harvested a wild herb, and they got a compound from it that they extracted. And over time they thought, well, let's grow this herb and get the same compound out of it. So they planted this herb, they cultivated, fertilized it, whatever. And over time, that compound that they were harvesting from that herb continued to decline, got lower and lower and lower. And so they said, well, we're just going back to harvesting the wild herb. And in the meantime, and they had used commercial fertilizer when they had gone to this cultivated herb. After that, they went and they started adding compost to this herb that was, again, cultivated. And over time, that compound in that cultivated herb came right up back up to what was in the wild herb. So my thing is that how many other, when we're looking at some of the things that we're doing, how many different compounds in whether it be, let's say, corn or hay or even food that we eat, what are some of the compounds that we don't have anymore or are at real low levels, but they're not tested? Because we're looking at just simple things like nitrogen and phosphorus and fiber and calcium, which are important. But a lot of other compounds that are also important that we're missing out on, and we're losing some of that because of a commercial fertilizer, or what are other, is it possibly the ORP reading that's way off, or we're getting these big fluctuations where our microbes are dying off, or we don't have the microbes that would normally be in the soil. And if we could maintain our ORP readings, that we could get some of these compounds reestablished in these plants. I don't know, but there is a difference. Any other questions anybody can think of?
So you're advocating aerobic manure pit versus anaerobic?
Correct.
Okay. But the anaerobic, you're going to say we're going to eat 150,000 homes or something like that off
yep.
of that methane. So they love methane.
And it's really easy. All you have to do is build a $20 million digester to get that, right?
No. That's all they care about.
Yeah. And the thing is it equitable or possible at all with this much input on one end to try to get some of this gas from manure?
Well,
I mean,
you gotta buy more fertilizer.
Right. So the one thing I have been looking at, I did have a number of manure tests that I have done this this winter, and so I'm going to be sending these samples in to see how these different additives affect some of these different numbers. And so I'm looking for something where we can get our, primarily our ORP reading down, and our ORP reading up, and our pH reading down. Because I think those are the biggest two things we have to do with this manure to have it more available.
Try so, a dumb question, Mike. Last summer, my pit dropped like 4 feet, you know, extreme heat and it dries.
Yep.
And I sent a sample in, and I knew back from my crop was all that, but it came back there. But it should be definitely some, hopefully, I go bare corn next year. I mean, if the manure is more drier, you know.
Yeah.
So, did you come to agitate? It was hard to agitate. It was just so
thick.
Thick,
yeah.
Enos? So, we're talking to folks on earlier. My thought was, when we start foliar feeding, have you tested the ORP readings in water? It can be different.
Oh, yeah. There's different ORP feeding in water, definitely.
Because that can change your all your foliar is going to correspond to the plant.
Yeah, and the thing is, generally what I'm looking at, if you look at, especially if we're using situations where you're using like the end fix, I'm generally going to want to look at where I have a reading in the upper level where I have oxygen in that water. And generally if we get a positive reading, that's going to mean we have oxygen. I better clarify that. This reading is based on all the different elements. And so there are different elements. For example, there's some compounds or elements that can raise the ORP significantly that aren't oxygen. We have fluorine, chlorine, bromine. Then we talked about our pesticides or insecticides. A lot of those are going to be fluorine, chlorine, bromine based. That means it will be highly oxidative. So we can say, well, I got a reading that's up 450, 500, and there's oxygen there. Not necessarily. It could be another compound that's causing that ORP to be high. So again, the ORP reading itself is fine to look at, but then you have to know where is that reading coming from. I just used the example of oxygen being on one side as an oxidator and hydrogen as being a reducer. But there's all your different compounds are going to fall into different ranges as far as being oxidizers or reducers. And some are going to be items that you want in your soil or in a plant. Does that make sense?
A prime example of that is 0060. We already bought it, actually, which is 47% chlorine.
Yep. Yep, exactly.
Well, that was chlorine. You shouldn't have to sanitize your milking
equipment. What you see in that situation, if you probably liquefied potassium chloride, you could get a high ORP reading. You know, and that doesn't necessarily, again, mean that there's oxygen there. You know, so if you had, let's say, you know, you tested some ORP reading, whether you had some water with some potassium chloride in it, so, oh, we have an ORP reading of 450 or 500. How do you think the NFIX are going to like that ORP reading with chlorine and not oxygen? They're not going to like it too well. Anything else that anybody can?
We don't really know what just the ingredient difference in the compounds, that one is that much higher than the other on the millivolt reading.
I believe so, that because because you said he had sawdust and the other material.
Tell them what the other mixture was.
The other compost was sawdust and wood chips.
What kind of wood sawdust?
What kind was hardwood chip?
What kind? You're gonna go with oak, because oak is very hard.
I guess it probably would have been mixed up.
Because like if we use sawdust for bedding cows, and you don't use oak because you get mastitis. Where you use your maples and stuff like that.
But your horse and your deer carcass had the same sawdust in it, didn't it?
No.
What did?
No. Uh-huh. Same sawdust, but it had the deer carcass would have had more sawdust.
But a different sawdust.
Okay.
That could be a factor.
So maybe that could have been part of it.
Okay. And generally, this is, again, this isn't always old suit true, but generally, your ORP reading and your pH are inverse. So in other words, normally, if you have a high pH, your ORP is going to be low. And if you have a high pH, low pH, then your ORP is going to be high. Generally, that doesn't always hold true. But it, with this compost, it holds true. When he had the eight pH horse compost, it had a negative ORP reading. Where this deer carcass one had a 6.3 pH and a higher ORP reading.
So in that one. The book of zone where they talk about what applying calcium sulfate, some of that to our dry bed packs and manure lagoons, kind of gave some ideas of what to use. And you said you're playing with some things. Are you thinking those are still where, like between you and Keith, are those still the things that we need to think about using?
Like the pelleted, I mean like the gypsum?
Because I know you had talked about some of the stuff you were playing with, like and stuff.
Right.
Is this test going to steer us a little differently on those things that we had?
Well, the thing is, I think what we can do now, at least we have something we can measure. Like, for example, if you're looking at a liquid manure, I can add some gypsum to it. Let it sit for a period of time, and I can test it before and after. I can know how that reading is going to change. You know what I mean? And I'd be like, yeah, it works, and how does it work? It would give me a little more information to make a decision of how well or poor some of these things work. And so again, I think the thing that we always end up looking at, we look at if we had an additive that has a certain nitrogen level or phosphorus level, it has a certain carbon level. We're looking at all these maybe different components, and maybe none of them are really giving us the right answer. There's something else there that is could be beneficial. And I think this ORP reading can be just something in addition to our normal testing that could give us a better idea of what we need to do in different situations. And again, this is all new to me. It's only been 5 or 6 months since I've been studying this. And this is way, way more. When you read this Olivier's research paper, I mean, it's highly technical type stuff. And there's a lot more information on this if you want to read that paper. It's very, very, very interesting. And he believes it could move us into this next level as far as productivity and knowing what to do as far as fertility practices. And so he's looking really highly of hopefully this getting adapted and people doing research so that this actually has a benefit out in the field. Any other questions?
You pull in your sample then
I have some samples that I'm going to send in.
Yeah, we got anything back to that.
No. Anything else?
Yeah, I did the goat manure, the bedding pack in the goat manure. Those two maybe reduce ammonia some, but when I go to clean it out a month later, it smells much worse.
And like last year, I used the Kelsol, and it just kind of gets rid of it and stays gone.
Yeah. Are you using the Kelsol yet or not?
Well, I'll just switch back to Kelsol.
Yeah.
I did not, but I...
Because I would use, as far as the retaining of that nitrogen and not get the ammonia, that the gypsum is going to do the job.
Okay. So just go back to that. Right. I am feeding the humates
Okay. Gotcha. Anything else?
For the ORP?
Yeah. Yes, I did. I have it in my other book. I know it was had a slight negative ORP, which would. If you know Tennessee, if you have a higher pH, right? I guess what I'm looking at, by the time it gets the whole mix together, what is the final ORP reading going to be? Because again, it still comes down to, if we have a negative ORP reading on this calc, on that soil biome, in this whole process, we're looking at the deal of gaining kind of and losing electrons. So if we combine this with some positive ORP reading numbers, it still will be a benefit in the whole process. Not that the negative reading is bad by itself. You know what I mean? By the time we apply it, and again, if we look at the minute amounts that we're using, it's not like putting 50 tons of liquid manure on per acre. But again, I think that the soil bio, it does have a negative reading, but I think by the time we add it with the different components, MS crystals, whatever else we have, we're going to still have them being probably in a positive ORP reading range. But it's something I don't know. I have to do more research and investigating to see how these numbers change. And even somebody brought up the deal with water. It depends on what your initial water is. Is it positive? Is it high negative? I think that could be throw off. And that could be the major thing. Your water is going to be your main component in that foliar or a soil spray. Anything else?
Anything else?
Well, if you're dumping that 10,000 gallons of manure and you're incorporating it right away, so, I mean, once that turns the scale, flip around somewhat?
Well, possibly. The thing I guess I look at it, like the fellow talked here, if you put it on top as a stays, if I have the ability for oxygen to actually raise that ORP reading, where if we incorporate it, now we have less of a chance of oxygen.
Aren't you charging the soil by incorporation?
As far as?
Well,
it's still there. Oh, yeah. That'll be true.
As compared to injection, that's what I was talking about. Yeah. A lot of these guys want to go through.
Yeah, if you if it tills the soil. Yeah.
Yeah, that might be good.
Basically, yeah. That's the big difficult area when it comes to they don't have a good meter to test in the soil. But then the other thing is, it gets to be when you do it. If you do the reading in the morning compared to night, it's going to change. If you get sun or if it gets cloudy, it's so hard to get. You don't can't get a specific number. It's almost like you get ranges. You might have, like here, you might have, in general, you might have a positive 700, and you might have a positive 300, and a fluctuation like that in a day. It can move that much. That's why it's a completely different number than like pH or some of these other numbers that are more static. This one has a lot more variance. So the whole thing is, we just want to make the variance as short as as minute as possible, so the plant doesn't have to expend energy to try to get into that sweet zone. So it's not a real exact science as far as being able to take this reading. I'm at 450, I'm good. Because you go up there at night and say, 700, what happened?
700, what happened?
And like the example, even like if you get rain, that's going to drop right down. Mm-hmm. Or even when we looked at the sand. The sandy ground, and let's say it doesn't get irrigated, why does that plant end up dying? Did it end up dying because we end up with 1,000 millivolt electrical reading? It got electrocuted?
It got electrocuted?
Yeah. You know, but so... And then adding water, it brings that millivolt reading down and the plant thrives. Anything else? Steak and lobster ready, Kevin?
So there's no research whatsoever that's correlating with mycotoxins anymore?
I know this, Olivia had stated, for example, like one of the main mycotoxins that we're going to get is usually going to be vomitoxin, duralinone, and most of these are fusarium-based mycotoxins. And as Olivier stated, that your fusariums are going to tend to thrive when we have millivolt readings that are too high. So I would, again, I'd have a tendency to believe that that's a situation that we have soils that have a tendency to be too high, and so the fusarium is going to be more prevalent because that's the conditions that it grows best in, and so we're possibly going to have more mycotoxin issues if that fusarium can thrive.
So what kind of meter are you using?
For this deal right here. Probe on end of it. This would be like what they use in the water treatment plants, that type of thing. Anything else?
Anything else?
Doesn't anaerobic manure attract a large amount of insect gatherings as well? Are they more prevalent around anaerobic conditions?
I don't know for sure.
I've read that they are.
It could well be.
You're saying that there will come insects after that they're sucking the peel, or the ones that. So, say, are you talking about if you have pilots in here?
You put manure out there, or like manure pit. You always have flies and stuff around.
You have flies around fresh stuff too. Looking calves are always blowing.
Wouldn't that attract those bugs to the field? Possible.
Well, I'll go back there. I know there's a neighbor of ours a number of years ago. They had army work to come across, and it destroyed this up towards nickel area. And the field grew this white, remote trees and everything. And it came into theirs, and they spread everything on top. I know that's what they do, but anyhow, they came in, they went into their field about 20, 30 yards, and they backed out and went changed direction. He showed it to me, so I was like, that was impressive.
Well, just one other additional thing as far as, again, that we... There's a lot of things that we don't realize that are going on because we can't see them. There was some research that was done similar that looked at anaerobic versus aerobic manure. And what the fellow did is he applied some manure that was treated that was aerobic, and then just regular manure that was anaerobic. And then they took an ion meter that measured the positive and negative ions in the air. And generally, if you look at, if you're next to the ocean and you have the ocean water coming up, the salt water, if you'd have one of those ion meters, you'd find out that the negative reading is really high. And typically, we tend to feel better if we're in a higher negative ion reading in the air. And so with this meter, it would measure the ratio between the positive and negative ions. Where they had the basic regular manure, the ratio between the positive and the negative ions was 1:1. And then when they walked and went over into the place where they had this treated manure and measured it, the reading was 197:1. So there was 197 negative ions to every one positive ion. What that exactly means, I don't know, but again, it's something where this was drastically different in this treated manure versus the manure that wasn't treated. Anything else? Yes. Once, twice? Okay, I guess we're ready for chow.
Just give us a few minutes if you want to make a lot of noise.
Okay. We'll do a prayer here quickly. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the many blessings you've given us, and we thank you for the ability to study and learn your creation, and we